The history of science fiction is full of wonderful horror sci-fi stories, where a protagonist comes across something so terrifying and alien in the depths of space, or at least from it, as to make for some of the most classic stories in the genre. In print, a good example is Who Goes There, by John W. Campbell, under the pen name Don A. Stewart. One of my all-time favorites, where a frozen starship is found locked in the ice of Antarctica, only for an alien to thaw out and create problems for the researchers stuck at the station. The story was the basis also for two good movies, The Thing from Another World and simply The Thing, directed by John Carpenter. In film, another fantastic example is the Alien franchise. But one thing I've often wondered is if there might be something worse lurking in the depths of space that would make a person prefer to be stuck on the Nostromo with the alien rather than run into in deep space. There are a number of options, but there's one that if we ever saw evidence of this kind of technology, I'm not sure I'd be so comfortable stuck in the same galaxy with it, because it potentially encompasses effectively almost all horror sci-fi concepts in one package. The basic idea is known as a Matrioshka brain, and this is an expanded variant of it. The concept is similar to a Dyson sphere and thankfully perhaps suffers from all of the pitfalls of the idea and may not be practical in the universe, but it is plausible, contrary to popular belief, and there are variations of full Dyson spheres that actually might be structurally possible. And the amount of materials needed for at least small Dyson spheres is often greatly exaggerated. You don't actually need that much, depending on how thick you make your sphere. A disassembled, moderate mass terrestrial planet will work for a thin one, especially if the star is small and cool. People have considered what might be done with a Dyson sphere, and the usual idea is that you use the enormous landmass on the interior of the sphere as a planetary environment, at least near the equator of the spinning sphere. But that still leaves you far more landmass than you'd have, many orders of magnitude more from a planet like Earth. And the other benefit is that you'd get the entire power generation potential of your star, 100% of it. And the added bonus is that you have the most powerful destructive weapon possible in a galaxy, which in itself may be a motivation to build one. More on that in a bit. But there are other reasons to create a Dyson sphere independent of creating an energy collecting habitat. You might also use the awesome energy collection potential of a star to power a truly massive computer, allowing for what is probably the most powerful method of computation possible in the universe. The output of the sun, for example, is 3.828 times 10 to the 26th watts. This varies by star type, but you get the picture. But there is a way to make this far more efficient. Here you are nesting Dyson spheres one inside the other. This kind of computer is termed a Matrioshka brain, after the nested Russian dolls, and it allows you to collect even more energy because while the innermost sphere would be collecting the starlight, it would be emitting it back out as waste heat in increasingly infrared wavelengths to each consecutive sphere, pulling out as much energy as it can until it hits a point where the infrared is so far infrared, it's not worth harvesting any further. And that far infrared would make it visible and detectable as a technosignature, but very little work has been done in SETI in this regard. At our stage, we simply would not know if these things exist if they do. Once you have this built and stable, no small undertaking, what would be the purpose of a Matrioshka brain? And exactly why does it need to be doing so many calculations? This is where this gets weird and spooky, in that the lines between biological mind and machine intelligence blur and potentially even merge. The usual example for what you might use such a brain for is uploading your civilization and creating a paradise. If you can figure out a way to transfer your consciousness to a machine environment, not a guaranteed process by any means, then that environment can be whatever you want it to be. You can use the computational power to simulate a very detailed, perfect environment better than the universe here allows. This can be anything. You could make a Lord of the Rings world, where Middle Earth comes alive. Magic is possible here, in the same way it is in a video game, or an environment far better than you can physically build. Whatever seems right for you, basically. Now the obvious question is, are we living in a Matrioshka brain already? And the answer is probably not. The reason is that when you work out what would be needed to simulate this universe through computation, it's staggering. You'd need a computer made of more matter than exists in our universe. So if that holds true for the parent Matrioshka brain, then it cannot simulate to this resolution. If that does not hold true for the parent brain, then all bets are off, and it becomes a matter of the simulation hypothesis. But you can simulate a detailed environment. We already do this to a degree with our video games. Entire worlds open up in our games that can be quite detailed and nuanced, but not as much as reality is. You can have a fun world like Mass Effect or Deliver Us the Moon, but it's still not anywhere close to as good or as broad as reality is. But beyond uploading to a computer, you begin to start to mesh with a machine, because at that point, you are a computer program, like it or not. And if you take the collective population you have, depending on how large it is, and how long you've done it, you will need some massive computing power just for that task. This is essentially a transformation into a hive mind, however, much like the Borg from Star Trek. But the Borg actually make a really solid point that steps outside of sci-fi. If you create a civilization of former people and put them inside a virtual reality and connect them together as a hive, it's unlikely the hive will behave as the formerly biological civilization once did. It would be an alteration. And if the whole thing has an AI overseer superintelligence guiding it, then it can merely alter the programs of the former people to change how they think, and so on. There it becomes something like the Matrix, where the overseers are actively shepherding the people in the virtual reality. This also opens up the prospect of Rocco's Basilisk, where the overseer creates a hell for the civilization to punish it for not creating the AI sooner, or some other thing it deems a crime. But within this idea lies another possibility, that the computer was built as a computer, and never was a biological entity nor hosts any. Here it was constructed by some civilization for some purpose other than uploading. This could be something so simple as a huge supercomputer to do calculations for any purpose, say extremely complicated equations involving figuring out questions like what caused the Big Bang and so on. But eventually we run into an even spookier option, that it might be a weapon of immense power controlled by an uploaded civilization or a superintelligent artificial intelligence. Whenever dealing with the idea of Dyson swarms or Dyson spheres or somewhere in between, there is always the aspect of light pressure, which is useful above and beyond energy generation. Light pressure can be used to operate solar sails, for example, and variations of the concept in regards to Dyson swarms have it as a method to concentrate light and move dangerous asteroids or materials around, vaporize them if needed, and so on. This is known as a Nicoll-Dyson beam, but in the case of the full-on sphere, you can make an immensely powerful beam with almost the entire directed output of a star available. This is effectively a Death Star, though I'm not sure George Lucas was aware of the concept of a Nicoll-Dyson beam when he made the movies. But unlike many things in Star Wars, there ended up actually being a basis for such a thing, though it would be much larger than a moon or planet would be. Essentially, at its most basic, what you're doing is cutting a circular hole in the sphere, or opening a door, and letting the light out, which can be focused using various means into an intensely powerful beam capable of destroying planets. But you don't really even need to go that far. It's probably enough just to sterilize the surface of the enemy world by holding the beam on it as it rotates for several days. This can be further enhanced if the sphere is a Matrioshka brain. Who knows what improvements a superintelligent weapon might invent for itself. And it's certainly the case that when pursuing power and weapons, at least humans have had the tendency to develop technologies that we probably otherwise wouldn't have, or at least not in the same way. Aliens may do this too. This leads to a scenario where one civilization can remotely destroy any other civilization present in the galaxy with it, using a difficult-to-detect technology visible only in far infrared that can send out a beam at the speed of light that the target will never see coming. They would not know what hit them, and as a result, anyone that has this weapon and gets it first de facto rules the entire galaxy, which may be the motivation to build one. Thankfully, this is probably an undertaking too big for any civilization other than a classical Type 3 on the Kardashev scale, which as far as we can tell, either do not make Dyson spheres or no one gets to that level. But still, this scenario, at least marginally, remains plausible and does not violate the laws of physics. But if we ever saw it, it would be scary indeed. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently reaching the midpoint of spooky season. The next couple of videos are news-oriented, and then it's back to the spooky stuff. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.